Objection 4, column 1, question 2.
10% of the married women were strongly aroused, 27% somewhat, and 63% not at all.
That's within a percentage point of the Chicago and St. Louis figures.
The reported ground temperature at Los Angeles International Airport is 89 degrees.
I don't think you gentlemen will be needing these. Mr. Radford?
Yep, that's mine.
And Dr. Chapman?
Yes, thank you.
Average American male more obsessed with sex?
You see, that's another loaded question. Until we complete our survey and compile the results, any answer to that question would be misleading.
What motivates the American female to marry?
She marries because of security, social acceptance, conformity, children, companionship.
Not love.
What happens if she's disappointed?
In extreme cases, divorce, a lover, an analyst, or a bottle.
You expect to find marital infidelity more common in an upper income bracket community like Briarwood?
No comment.
Do you feel that a report on the subject of sex belongs on the bestseller list?
I feel that my job is to gather facts and not tell people what to think. You see, it's...
We're running out of time, Doctor. Dr. Chapman is due to speak at the Briarwood Women's Club in less than 2 hours. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Driver, will you wait a minute, please?
Hey, what's the big rush?
Debbie hasn't got her lunch.
Relax, she won't stop.
I don't know, I was sure I gave it to her.
Look, she found it.
Oh.
Frank, I might be a little late tonight. I'm going to help out with the nurse's aid class. Did you hear what I just said?
Perfectly, you may be a little late tonight, the nurse's aid class. Looks like another tough day, Sarah. Let's stay home tonight.
When don't we stay home?
It's a nice house, I like it. What's wrong with that?
Drive carefully. Fred? It's me. I'm going to be a little late. I'll be there.
I called the airport.
They're not coming.
The lecture will start on schedule. Dr. Chapman's on his way now. I missed you at the board meeting last night.
Father and I were working on Boy's book.
It's not right. It's not right for you to be cooped up in that house. Boy's been dead for 2 years. I want you to get out more.
Oh, Grace. I do go out. As a matter of fact, I have a dinner date tonight. Ted Dyson.
That Dyson's an old friend of your husband's, and that hardly counts. I want you to have a beau. A real beau.
Honey, where's Dr. Chapman's lecture going to be held?
The women's club.
Oh, silly, I know that, but which room?
The
garden room. It's more intimate, and we can see those two marvelous pieces of sculpture that you sold the club last month.
I suppose we should have donated them, but this is such a commercial world. What? What did I say?
I was just thinking of all the fascinating things I'm going to tell Dr. Chapman. You, my love, are going to be in a book. Goodbye, darling.
Bye, Annie.
Leave an extra bottle?
And you?
Just till a regular fella gets back. He's down with the flu.
What'd he tell you about me?
I never met him.
Well, here's your money.
See if I have change.
What's your name?
Bob. Bob Jensen. You live here alone?
Yes, I live alone.
She was attending a lecture of this kind, why, I'd have hit the ceiling. I probably would have told her to stick to her washing and ironing.
While your presence here indicates that your husbands are not as prudish, the fact remains that prudery in general is far from dead. In many sections of this country, sex is a secret and shameful function. An unhealthy attitude persists. Too many women suffer from too little knowledge about a subject that occupies a major and crucial part of their lives. Why, as many as 4 or 5 out of every 10 women in this room probably suffer from this lack of knowledge. As a result, their happiness is seriously impaired. The subject of sex remains under the table, back room, back street, suppressed, unknown, and always indecent. My associates and I believe that through our findings, these women will come to understand that sex is decent, clean, and dignified. Now, to help us succeed in our task, we must have your complete confidence, your trust. We need it. We ask for it. And to this end, I want to assure you that we are fact finders, no more, no less. We are not in the business of appraising, correcting, or commenting. To many of you, the idea of discussing intimate sexual details with a stranger, even though he is hidden from you by a screen, an embarrassing idea. If I could use one word to describe our approach, that word would be detachment. In the final analysis, each of you will have been absorbed by the whole. In no way could our published findings ever embarrass a single person. Never could the results be traced to a single individual. Well, I want you to imagine that you're speaking not to a man, but to an uncritical machine that has never heard a single sexual history that it has not heard repeated time and time again. I ask that you take home the brochures that you found on your seats. Study them. If you have any questions, call my secretary, Miss Selby, here at the club. When you are convinced of the importance of our project, would you please fill out the enclosed card and mail it to me? Do not sign it. You will be known to us only by the number that you find in the upper right-hand corner. To those of you who prefer not to volunteer, we understand. To the rest, thanks.
Marvelous. I find this entire lecture perfectly disgusting.
I'm going to give the board a complete list of all the people who didn't show up.
They're probably the blue nose, the sexually suspect. Did I miss much?
No. Well, he said that 4 out of 5 were suffering from lack of...
You didn't take notes.
Knowledge. For Jeffrey. Well, now I'm off to the beach with my faithful little tape recorder. I'm speaking my poems against the roar of the waves and the cry of the gulls.
Against?
You know, like that Greek by the sea, Demosthenes.
Demosthenes. Didn't he fill his mouth with pebbles?
Only because he stammered. And Jeffrey says it's good for my projection.
See that you mail in your card.
I'm going to do that right away. And don't forget the party Tuesday week. And Kathleen, don't you dare come stag.
Well, I suppose I might as well face Dr. Chapman. I may be ours.
I'll drive you home.
Thanks.
You don't mind?
82. Weren't we promised a full turnout?
Yeah, I think the doctor had figured around 150. Mm-hmm. I see you made the front page. Mm-hmm. Along with Dr. Jonas.
I'm Grace Waterton. Is Dr. Chapman available?
Sorry, he had an appointment at the university. This is his assistant, Mr. Radford.
He's the one that's responsible for this wretched turnout. He appeared in front of the board and prohibited. That was the very word he used, prohibited. But you tell Dr. Chapman that Grace Waterton's not through fighting. I'll have his volunteers here if I have to march them up at gunpoint.
Thank you, Mrs. Waterton. I'm sure Dr. Chapman will be pleased with all you're doing for us.
I'm terribly sorry about this, and I'll do my best.
That ain't so good.
What's his game?
You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm not aware that Dr. Chapman ever used the word love, either in print or speech. I miss it. All your diagrams, graphs, tables are devoted to the physical act. Quantity, frequency, how much and how often. But that doesn't tell these women a damn thing about love or happiness. This is separating sex from affection, warmth, tenderness, devotion. And I don't think that it should.
How can you measure love?
Then why pretend that the physical act is a measurement of love?
Dr. Chapman never said that.
But by not saying anything to the contrary, that's what he infers, and people believe it. People read your digits, make the comparisons, and then label themselves either normal or abnormal.
You're just reading one side of the coin. Turn it over. Obviously, it reads exactly the opposite of what you've been arguing. Show these women the factual statistics relating to their behavior, and it removes the shame and abnormality from them. I say this is helpful. It liberates millions from needless repressions and guilt.
I'm not sure I like that kind of a gamble. Have you ever considered, in terms of human suffering, the cost of your surveys? These women come in to see you, sick or well. Most of them have everything in order, properly in place, properly repressed, and they function. Then you start hammering your questions, digging and prying. Each question a painful probe into areas properly forgotten. Then all order disappears. You start an uncontrolled chain of unwholesome and noxious forces. And you don't follow through. You don't stay with the subject. Help them put everything back in place again. You set off a chain reaction, then let them go. And I wonder, go where? To what? What are they like afterwards? What becomes of them?